the question is, write down. I'll write down the question here. Try to solve this question. The question is, blood freezes at Kelvin and a solution of 3 gram of urea in 250 gram of water freezes at 272.63 Kelvin. Calculate the osmotic pressure at 300 Kelvin. The density of blood is given. D of blood means the density of blood is 1 gram per ml at 300 Kelvin. Solve this question, guys, and then we'll start the next part in it. Try to solve this question. Okay, I'll tell you what you need to do here. See, osmotic pressure we have to find out. Correct? Osmotic pressure, that is pi, and pi is equals to CRT. R value you know, right? T is given, that is 300 Kelvin. C you need to find out, concentration. Right? So concentration you find out from the formula of, because blood freezes, the freezing temperature is given. So delta TF formula you use and find out molality, right? Find out molality, that will be the concentration, and then you find out pi. So first of all, what you do, you just find out the concentration, okay? And then we'll see. Tell me, what is the concentration you are getting? Anyone? What is the concentration term? What is the concentration you are getting here? Anyone? What is the concentration you are getting? Let me know, guys, whether you are getting or not. Otherwise, I'll solve this. Okay, I'm solving this. Wait, I'm solving this. See, in this question, the blood freezes at 272.44 Kelvin at a solution of 3 gram of urea in 250 gram of water. Correct? So delta TF, so delta TF is equals to KF into M. Okay, KF into M. And KF is also not given in this question. Okay, fine. KF is also not given in this question. Okay, so first of all, you see the molality is what? M is equals to the number of moles, which is 3 gram of urea divided by the molecular mass of urea is 60. The whole thing is divided by, okay, this is given, divided by the mass of water, which is 250 gram into 1000. This gives you the molality. Okay. And delta TF is given here, which is 2.72. Okay, fine. This molality will find out. Delta TF is what? Blood freezes at this, solution of 3 gram of urea freezes at this. Okay. So freezing point of blood is given and the solution freezes at this. Okay. So water is the solvent here. Right? Water is the solvent and its freezing point is 0 degrees Celsius, which is nothing but 273 Kelvin. So if I write down here, TF is equals to 0 degrees Celsius, the freezing point of water, which is equals to 273 Kelvin, and TF dash, it is given in the question, which is 272. TF dash is given in the question, which is 272.63 Kelvin. The freezing point of the solution is this. Now, delta TF is what? TF minus TF dash, that is nothing but 273 minus 272.63, which is 0.37 Kelvin. This is delta TF. Now, with this delta TF and molality, we'll find out KF first. So, KF is equals to what? KF is equals to delta TF is 0.37 and molality is 3000 into 250 into 60. So when you solve this, the KF value will get around 1.85. This is the value of KF. Okay, with this value of KF, now when the freezing point, because the blood freezes at this point, okay, and the water freezing point is 273 Kelvin. So if the freezing point is this 272.44, right? So for that case, in what we can have the delta TF is equals to again 273 minus 272.44. Okay, so when you subtract this, you'll get 0.56 is the delta TF, Kelvin or degree Celsius. Okay, so this is the temperature difference we have when the blood freezes at this point and water at this, correct? This will is also equals to KF into M. KF value we already have at this temperature. So molality will find out, and that molality will be 0.56 divided by the KF is 1.85. Okay. So this is approximately equals to 0.303. Now the concentration we have already. So C pi is equals to C R T. C is nothing but 0.303, R is 0.082, and the temperature is given. It is at 300 Kelvin. We need to find out. Okay, so temperature is 300. So when you solve this, you'll get 7.45 or 6 atmospheric approximately. Understood this? Let me know, guys, first. Understood? So this molality is the molality of blood, because osmotic pressure of blood we need to find out. So we need to find out the concentration of blood, and for concentration of blood we need KF, because TF is there, TF dash is there, right? KF we need to find out. So KF will find out from this formula. So you'll find out KF, substitute here, find out molality of blood, and then pi is equals to CRT we have to use. Got it? Okay, next write down. See, we have discussed about the colligative property. Now, we are going to discuss about the colligative property when the solution, when the solute is electrolyte. okay, when the solute is electrolyte. So write down next abnormal colligative property. Abnormal colligative property. You see, this abnormal colligative property is nothing but same. We don't have much difference into that. Okay. But the only difference is this property we use when the solute is electrolyte. Solute is electrolyte. There is nothing much to understand here. Right? So what happens, you see, if the solutes are electrolyte, like suppose I am using this NaCl. NaCl solute I am using. So when you put this NaCl into any solvent, what happens? NaCl dissociates into its ions. Right? So NaCl, suppose if you place in any solvent, it converts into Na plus and Cl minus. Okay? So Na plus and Cl minus, see, the number of ions in the solution increases now. You have given NaCl, it becomes Na plus and Cl minus. So the number of ions increases, and the colligative property are those properties which depends upon the number of particles. Right? Depends upon the number of particles. Correct? So when the number of particles increases in the solution, why? Because the solute is electrolyte, then the colligative property also changes here. Right? So that's why this kind of property, you will calculate or find out the property according to NaCl, because you have added only one particle into it, but in the solution it becomes Na plus and Cl minus. Okay, so number of particles increases, right? Number of particles increases. That is why the colligative property that we expect, we are not getting the same colligative property here. Right? So colligative property also changes a bit. That's why these kind of properties, when the solute is electrolyte, we are calling it as abnormal colligative property. Okay? So for this, right? So this formula is exactly same that we did, but to counter this, this abnormal behavior, we use a term, and that we call it as Wenthoff factor. Okay, so see, what you have to keep in mind, you have to understand this, that the solute that you are using, whether it is electrolyte or non-electrolyte, like I said, urea, glucose, sucrose, these are non-electrolyte. Okay, these are non-electrolyte, and this does not dissociate. Okay, but NaCl, so this you have to keep in mind. Okay, sometimes in the question they'll mention. Okay, they'll mention that we use in the solution of electrolyte, non-electrolyte solute or electrolyte solute, like this it is mentioned. But sometimes when these kind of solutes they use, you should keep this in mind, that these solutes are non-electrolyte solutes and these solutes are electrolyte solute. Okay, so the point is, in case of abnormal colligative property, what is the term that we have to introduce? Okay, so first of all, you write down here, If the solute particles dissociates or associates, dissociates or associates in both the cases, because in both cases the number of particles changes, dissociates or associates, upon dilution then there will be a deviation from the expected colligative properties and these properties are called abnormal colligative properties. Abnormal colligative properties. This deviation from the expected value, this deviations is measured by measured by a term called Wenthoff factor, which is represented by I. Okay, more value of I, more will be the deviation. Got it? Copy it down, guys. Yes, fructose also, it is a non-electrolyte.